Amen. We're going to the book of Luke chapter 24 on this morning. Luke chapter 24. Luke 24. When you have it, say amen. You need more time, say wait. For the word of the Lord in Luke chapter 24, starting at the first verse. And the word of the Lord begins to read as this. Now upon the first day of the week, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, that's today. Very, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre, and told all these things unto the 11, and to all the rest. And we're going to stop right there. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for your word, which has come to bring power. Your word, which has come to bring might. Your word, which has come to bring clarity and to bring strength. Your word, which comes to bring deliverance. Because only your word can bring about a change. So, Lord, we thank you for such a time as this. For it's not my mother, nor is it my father, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Lord, you know what's going on in every household. You know what's going on with every individual. Satan, the Lord rebukes you right now. We declare and take full notice against any assignment that you have against your people. For we are the people of the Most High God, and you will not oppress us. You will not depress us. You will not cause us to be in a state of depression. We rebuke it now in the name of Jesus. We speak over our children. We speak over our spouses. We speak over our siblings. We speak over our parents. We speak over our environment in the name of Jesus. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh upon your people, for we are your people. We are the sheep of your pasture. And Lord God, we tell you thank you that no weapon that is formed against us shall prosper. And Lord God, we continue to give you the glory. We continue to give you the honor. And we continue to give you the praise. All blessings. Hallelujah. All blessings. We thank you now. We count it as done. We believe it as done. We receive it as done. Right now, by faith in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen and amen. Come on and give God praise as you're taking your seats. Amen. To God be the glory for the great things he has done and for the wonderful things he's preparing to do. Amen. A word to leave with you on this day. Amen. Does your word mean anything? Does your word mean anything? I want you to know, amen, as we begin to go into this scripture and topic, Luke was one of the ones that recorded of the books of his encounters with Jesus. Luke was not identified as a disciple by name of Jesus' calling, but he was a man of prestige. He was a man that had something to say and people would listen. Luke was a doctor in his own right, a physician in his own right, a man knowing that all that he has recorded, a man, is evidence and facts to an encounter with Jesus. When you begin to tell your story, amen, it's nice that you could tell somebody else's story, but something happens when you tell your own story, amen, because you lived it. You've gone through it. You suffered with it, and you have endured from it, and God brought you out, amen. Let's do me one favor. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, out of all that I've been through, I still got my joy. Yeah. I still got my joy. And the blessing of this is that it caused my words to speak about Jesus to be more profound. Amen. Because I, as I stated, I've gone through it. And but the blessings of it, I've come out. Amen. I want you to know, amen, before I really get deep into this sermon, I want you to know somebody in here was going through. And you were trying to figure out what should be my next move. But God said, be not weary in your well-doing, for you are going to reap in due season if you faint not. It may seem like it's hard, but God said, I've given you all sufficiency to declare and to decree. Whatever you start declaring in the name of Jesus, he said, that's what's going to begin to manifest on your behalf. He said, according to your faith, so shall it be unto you. Amen. Trust me, I am a God of my word, in case you haven't heard, because I was God. Hey, listen, up in here, God's trying to let you know, I stand by what I speak on. Amen. He said, I was man enough to die, but God enough to get right back up, to let you know that all power is in my hand, and it ain't over till I say that it's over. Just when you're ready to throw in the towel, God said, no, be still and know that I am God. Just when you're ready to turn your back, God said, no, amen, get ready, because you're about to be blessed with something, amen, you've been praying for, blessed with something you've been crying for, blessed with something you've been scratching and scraping for. You haven't told nobody about the sickness that the doctor told you about, amen, but God said, rest assured, I am the Lord thy God that shall supply all of your needs according to my riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I don't know who that's for, but I want you to do me one favor. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, he's a God of his word. Yeah. When we began to look and began to speak about this scripture and topic of Luke, amen, for what is a word? A word, according to Webster's description, it is a sound or combination of sounds that has a meaning, and it's spoken or possibly has a written interpretation. I want you to know, amen, every now and then you have to know that your word means something, amen, because your word represents your personal integrity, amen. But the question is, people are given their word but have no integrity to follow up what they're speaking. Amen. Don't let you be caught being one that's like that. Amen. If you give your word, amen, follow through on your word. If you say you're going to do something, follow through and do it. Amen. Amen. Please know and understand, in the Bible, it began to say, it's like when you give your word, that's like making a vow. And the scripture said that it's better that you make a vow and keep it than to make a vow and to break it. Because in the Old Testament times, there was a time, amen, you would make a vow, and the only way to break your vow is either by death. Amen. But I'm so grateful, amen, that somebody made a vow to us. They used to sing a song years ago. I made a vow to the Lord and I won't take it back. Amen. Some old saints know what I'm talking about. Amen. But what does it mean to keep your word? It means to keep your word. It means to stand by what you say and follow through and not go back. Amen. Too many people are giving their word, as I said earlier. Amen. And you put your trust in man. Amen. And before you know it, they let you down. But I want you to know, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him and he will direct your path. How many of you know that God will do it? Oh, I guess we don't have a lot of people to know. God will do it. God will do it. He promised to do it exceedingly. He promised to do it abundantly. He promised to do more than we can even ask or think. Why? Because he's God. As I said earlier, for your word is your bond. For when you put your word out there, amen, to someone, they are looking for you to keep what you have put out there. But here now, as Jesus was doing his ministry, he lived, he loved, he served, amen. He shared all that he possibly could with them that would hear and receive. But as Jesus performed his ministry, Jesus heard some things. Jesus saw some things. He was very careful in speaking some things, because he knew that his word had power. Amen. And if he spoke something, it will come to pass. You got to be careful of your words. Amen. Amen. Some people say, well, I could just say what I want to say. No, you can't just say whatever you want to say, because your words have power. Amen. You can't tell me, amen, you hate me and you did that in the heat of the moment. No, you hate me because it was in your heart. Amen. Some people say, well, I said it. I'm sorry that I said it. No, don't be sorry. It's in you. It had to come up out of you, because out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth is going to speak. Amen. So trust and rest assured. Amen. Watch your mouth. Watch your words, because your words have got power. Amen. And I want you to know, amen, some people haven't been speaking lately, but I want you to start speaking some things as not as though they are. The enemy has put a muzzle on you, but if you start declaring the word of God over your life, I believe God's going to show up and show out. Hallelujah. Because he's that kind of God. And as he's that kind of God, please know and rest assured, no weapon. Oh, I wish I had three people know I'm talking about. No weapon that forms against you shall prosper. But in order for that to happen, you got to speak it. For Jesus, amen, was a man of integrity. He was then and still is today the Son of the living God. Amen. As I said, he lived, he loved, he served, and then he reigned. But as Jesus was the epitome of a sinless life, please know, he said, no matter all that's going through, I give you my word, amen, that you will not die if you receive me into your life. You will not falter, amen, if you receive me into your life. You will not be able to do what you feel you want to do as long as I am in supreme being. Amen. I am the true and living God. So here now, amen, we understand Jesus as he went through his ministry. Amen. He had to pull some things together. Amen. Because there's some stuff that was going on that people need to get clarity on. Please know and understand. So out of all that Jesus went through, amen, we heard stories. We've seen the passion of the Christ. We've seen all these different things. Amen. But nothing really depicts what really Jesus went through. Amen. Where he was in judgment hall, and they took the cattail whip of 9 straps filled with metal and glass, and they swung it at him and yanked it back, and skin came hanging off his face, and the blood just came dripping down all of his body. And they sat there and they spat on him and they ridiculed him and they put a crown of thorns on his head. And I wish I had two people know I'm talking about. I want you to know, amen, all the stuff that he went through, amen, so that we don't have to go through it. Amen. So he's trying to let you know, listen, in the midst of all that I've gone through, and then they put a heavy weight called a cross on his back. Amen. Someone said, I would have given up a long time ago. I'm one of the ones that I would have given up a long time ago. Have your way. Amen. But see, it wasn't me. Amen. But it's not about me. It's about Jesus. He understood that the purpose was greater than the person. When you understand that your purpose is greater than the person, you'll find yourself doing things in a different manner, because the purpose has got to be fulfilled. He said, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day, because night is coming when no man's going to be able to work. So I got to do all that I can. So as he was walking towards Golgotha, Golgotha called a place of skulls. Here now, this man that knew no sin that came just to represent his father. It was God incarnated in the Son, reconciling man back to himself. Here now, he walks to Golgotha being ridiculed. Everybody that he may have healed, everybody he may have delivered, nobody stood and came to his defense. Amen. Just when you need people to come to your defense, you can't find nobody nowhere, but they don't mind being there when it's time to do the deed. Oops, did I say that? Amen. But please, no one understand. Amen. Nobody would come and testify on his behalf. Amen. But Jesus still realized, in the midst of all this, I still have to move forward. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, in spite of it all, you still got to move forward.
Still got to move, you got to move, you got to move, you got to move. And the reason why you got to move, because the enemy can't hit a moving target. But too many people are getting hit because they're standing still. Too many people are getting caught because they're standing still. Too many people are getting locked up because they're standing still. No, baby, you got to keep it moving. You got to keep it moving. Keep it moving. Keep it moving. Keep it moving. He could have stayed and dropped the cross and said, Father, let the angels deal with this. I don't want to deal with this no more. But he kept it moving. And, you know, it had to take God to have somebody, because if anybody spit on you today, you know you're going to be ready to snatch them. Let's call it for what it is. If you spit on me, I'm laying Jesus to the side for a minute. Hallelujah. And I'm going to pray my deliverance after. If you spit on me, y'all pray for, I'm not delivered yet. I'm still working out my soul salvation. But you will not spit on me. Now you can talk about me. That's fine, because every time you talk about me, God gonna bless me. Every time you come at me, God's still gonna bless me. Every time you think you got me down, God's still gonna bless me. Every time you think you got it made, God gonna bless me. Why? Because he's that kind of God. Unless he's that kind of God, amen. He said there's no weapon that formed against you shall prosper. So here now, Jesus, as he goes to the cross, I'm just building my case and I'm going to bring it to a close. Jesus goes to the cross, and as he goes to the cross, amen, here now they ridiculed him so much. But in the midst of all that hell that they put him through, what's the first words that come out of his mouth? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So everybody that talk about me, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, because they fail to realize it was only a season that I'm going through. And you got to be careful how you treat me in this season, because I'm not going to always be here when I come out of this season, baby. You better make sure you treated me right when I was in my season, because when I come out, I'm coming out with a vengeance. When I come out, I'm coming out with a praise. When I come out, I'm coming out with stability. When I come out, I'm coming out with stamina. When I come out, I'm coming out with glory. Do me one favor, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, there will be glory after this. There will be glory after this. There will be glory. There will be glory after this. There shall be glory after this. So as his first words were, Father, forgive him, give them for what they know not what they do. His last words were, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Too many of you are giving your spirit to man instead of giving it to God. And you're wondering why you can't get a deliverance. Stop giving your spirit to man. So what, they laugh at your jokes? So what, they eat your cooking in your face but talk behind your back? Call it what it is. Because we're dealing with man. Man will do it. Man will do everything he possibly can to get your confidence. And if I can get your confidence, the rest is history. But he said, I'm a God of my word. So as he said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. And the reason why he said that, because he said, I'm not leaving no more remnants of my physicality here on earth. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. But you see, that happened on Friday. But on Saturday, he led captivity captive and went down and knocked on hell's gates. As he knocked on hell's gates, he said, wait a minute. I got to answer a question, because Job asked the question, if a man die, shall he live again? Jesus said, hold on, just wait a minute. I'll answer that for you. So he went knocking on the gates of hell. And Satan thought he had him. Just like some of y'all in here right now. Satan thinks he's got you. But little does he know, you just stirred up a hornet's nest. You thought you had me. You ain't seen nothing yet. I'm just getting started.
And as I'm just getting started, so he says, open the door. Satan just thought he raised his victory flag. I want you to know, the enemy thinks he's got the victory over your life. Oh, you didn't know that? The enemy's constantly waving a victory flag over your life. But I don't know about you, but you got to say the devil is a liar. He has no victory over here. As for me and my house, let me bring this to a close. We're here now as he began to go down and grab them that were captive, because many died with the hope of Jesus, waiting for the Messiah to come. So they died with that hope. So now here comes Sunday morning. Early Sunday morning, there was a shaking in the earth. And as it was a shaking in the earth, here now, everybody that was dead, that died with a hope, got up and started walking all throughout the city. You know, if you see somebody you know that died, and you see them coming your way today, that I know you were buried, because I preached your eulogy, and I see you up now. There's a problem. So here now, everybody got up with the hope under that first coming of Jesus. And here now, the resurrection, when he got up, the veil of the temple ripped from top to bottom. Not from the bottom up, but from the top to the bottom. Ripping it open, letting you know, you don't have to see the Catholic priest no more. We don't have nothing against Catholicism. But however, God provided a way that we don't have to see the priest no more. We can come to the high priest, and his name is called Jesus. He's known by attributes of wonderful, counselor, mighty God, Prince of Peace, everlasting Father. These are attributes of him. And as these are attributes of him, he said, listen, I now have the power over death, hell, and the grave. But here come the women that wanted to finish what they started because they couldn't really prepare his body because it was the beginning of the Sabbath. And here now they come to the tomb. And as they come to the tomb, do I have a witness to know anytime you're in pursuit of Jesus, he'll move some stones out your way? So they went in with the expectancy that the stone was going to be there. But then again, you have to question that. Did they? They didn't know what to expect when they got there. They were just going on faith. Sometimes you got to go by faith in order to get the result that you're seeking. Everything is not going to always be in your face, because the just shall live by their faith. So here now, let me close this. I'm not hacking today. So let me bring this to a close. Here now, Jesus was not there. And the angels were in the tomb, one at the head and one at the foot, giving you indication, no matter what's going on around you, I got you covered. No matter what they say on the job, I still got you covered. No matter what the doctor's office may say, I still got you covered. No matter what the teacher said about your child, I still have them covered. So as the angel sat there, why seek ye the living among the dead? Watch out for people that practice divination. You got Susie the witch out of Long Island. That's what they call her. I'm only going by what I've heard them say. I'm not saying I'm only going by what I heard them say. I'm only repeating what I heard them say. She says it's a gift, but the Bible said it's the spirit of divination. When you're sitting there talking to questionable dead people. and telling people what the dead person had said. They didn't say why they were living. Let me tell you something. Don't be fooled by that. For the Bible said it is once appointed unto man to die. And after the death comes the judgment. So the spirit that came from God now goes back to God. So I don't know who she's talking to. She ain't talking to me. See, you got people that get caught up in all kinds of stuff because they're looking for an instantaneous word from the Lord. But if you read your Bible, you'll get an instantaneous word from the Lord. If you get on your knees and pray, you'll get an instantaneous word from the Lord. If you in proper fellowship with your brothers and sisters, you'll get a word from the Lord. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And then you go down to verse 29. It says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. And we beheld his glory as the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. So only the Word can bring you out. But the question is, what does the Word mean to you? Does the Word make you want to jump? Does the Word make you want to slide to the side? Does the Word make you want to holler? Does the Word make you want to throw your hands in the air and praise him like it? Or does the Word want you to listen to Lemonade? Please, no one understand, there's so many things that's going on that can snatch your thoughts. But God's a God of his word. If you trust his word, he'll bring you out. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, trust the word, he'll bring you through. Come on and give God praise.
Praise the Lord. This is Bishop Dwayne Castro, the senior pastor of the Universal Love, Peace, and Joy Church of God. I thank you for taking the time to listen to the word of this message, and we pray that the message will touch your heart and will be able to bless your life. It will be a wonderful thing to hear from you. When you have an opportunity, please reach out to me by calling 718-566-7950 or drop me an email at ulpj7@aol.com. Once again, that'll be ulpj7@aol.com. Until that time, may the Lord continue to richly bless you and everyone connected to you. Please know we're praying God's deliverance.